All right. So if you're moving from M365 Commercial to the M365 GovCloud, out of the box, there's a few things you need to know, right? First off, Teams audio and phone system, not part of the Microsoft stack in the sense of them hosting the voice service itself. The licenses are there, but you have to do something called direct routing. So this immediately is different compared to what's available inside of Commercial. Other things like Microsoft Copilot, you know, those are not available yet. So kind of more modern SKUs, more modern capabilities, more, you know, newer product releases, you're going to look at about a 6-month delay, give or take, in the GovCloud. That used to be like 2 or 3 years. So we're luckily well caught up to this point. But a few things to consider as you kind of go through this is your identity, right? So intra-ID, you're going to migrate that, but part of that migration is single sign-on applications. So during this migration cutover, you need to start coordinating with your line of business applications and the teams that are supporting those to make sure that you're able to cut over, because once this vanity domain moves over to GCC High, you know, we'll use abc.com here. Once it moves over, because that domain can't live in two tenants at once, your single sign-on has to change immediately after, right? And so that's a big one. Another big one is Power Platform. So Power Platform is fantastic.
This is Power BI. This is
Power BI, Power Apps, Power Automate. Most of the Power Apps and Power Automate, all of those move pretty seamlessly. The one thing that doesn't move seamlessly is Power BI. So especially if you have a Power BI gateway. So that is a big consideration of a step of recreation that you're going to have to do and redeployment from a Power BI gateway perspective. You can do staging and things like that prior to the migration to rebuild this data set, but it is something really, really good to know there. One that people don't think about it much is third-party apps, specifically like the Teams App Store and third-party workflows inside of SharePoint, not native workflows. GCC High specifically has very few, if not any, third-party integrations. Not for lack of Microsoft wanting it, but because these developers and all these other software applications just haven't built the APIs to integrate into the GovCloud. So yeah. If you're using, you know, let's say, what's a good example? Let's say you're using the Teams App Store and you've got third-party apps, and you have tabs inside of your channels or groups. You won't be able to have those for any non-Microsoft product in the GovCloud, right? So as you're kind of going through systematically, these are all really important things to know. And the biggest one, and I'll end here, Jacob, is devices. Mm-hmm. So on the devices, there's kind of two ways to look at this. On the mobile device side, you have BYOD, which you can easily do and bring across. That's an unenroll and re-enroll activity, maybe takes 3 to 5 minutes, and a user can easily self-service that. However, if you're migrating a corporately owned device enrolled in something like Apple Business Manager, that's a wipe and reload of that iOS device or Android device if you're using Android Work or Enterprise. So again, it's very kind of time intensive to do this, but one of even longer than that is any direct join Windows devices. Mm-hmm. So if it's a hybrid join Windows device, there's actually some really cool stuff that we've been able to build to migrate those seamlessly. However, if it's a direct join Windows device, you have to disjoin and rejoin that device just like you were rejoining it to the domain for the first time. And that could take, you know, 30 minutes to an hour and a half to get the user fully set back up into a working state.
Right.
And so you multiply that times 10, 20, 50, 100 users, that's problematic, right? Yeah. So that's kind of where we are. Those are some really good kind of things to start thinking about.
And that's once you're ready to pull the trigger to actually do those cutovers, right? And so
that's right.
You know, we talk about this all the time. People are like, oh, it's so crazy that you tell people it takes 6-12 months or longer to do one of these projects. And you're like, the technical part of doing the cutover is not the hard part.
No.
The hard part is the organizational friction, the coordination. You know, you have other things going on and you have to do this cutover. And so we were just talking to somebody today and they were like, well, we want to do this migration and cutover on a weekend, right? We're going to do it on a Friday, which is perfectly normal. That's the standard time that you do it. There's only so many weekends available. Yep. And our backlog is growing at a pretty rapid rate at this point. And I mean, it's like the anticipation of the rule is waking people up. And so our weekends are getting booked out now for quite some time. And now people are having to consider, do we want to do a cutover and migration in the middle of a week?
Yep.
Like in the middle of a business week, which, you know, we have a lot of confidence in what we do. We do this a lot. Yeah. We've been doing this for a long time, but there, you know, it's a disruptive process. You're changing things. And if you're changing things on a Tuesday versus on a Friday, this is one of the costs that comes with waiting, because now all of a sudden you're like, okay, we know we need to do it. We want to sign up and get our stuff switched over. We know we're going to go with you guys. Here's the plan, blah, blah, blah. We don't have an open weekend until January, which means you're going to have to do this on a Wednesday. And if something happens, then Wednesday issues are more difficult than Friday issues.
Yep.
So it's just something to consider in terms of one of those phantom costs of waiting.
Absolutely. The other piece of that is Microsoft throttles migrations. So if you have a ton of data, we have to wait for all of the data to get moved over there, right? So there's a lot of delays. I mean, we see sometimes migrations taking 2, 3, 4 months, you know, just based on the amount of data Microsoft and Microsoft throttling, right? So
yeah, absolutely.